Evelyn Thomas. Welcome to my YouTube channel. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, you know, you are such like one of the biggest artists from the 80s, you know. There is like, Hi-NRG is like a gorgeous song from the 80s. I think that you are very happy for that or not.
Oh, absolutely. Are you kidding me? Oh, that song took me everywhere. That song was a monster.
Yeah.
You know, and it was very hard to follow up with anything because it was so big, we couldn't find anything to follow it up with. You know?
But I wanna talk about your beginnings because a Hi-NRG was on the charts on United Kingdom, but you have other songs on the charts before Hi-NRG. So I wanna talk about your beginnings.
I started singing jazz in the beginning.
Wow.
And a lot of people say, you know, she comes from church. But the funny thing about the church thing, I love going to church. And but I never sung in the choir. I had a cousin that was a choir director, and for some reason he says, I don't know, Evelyn, your voice sticks out like a sore thumb. So we can't have you in the choir because every time we try to get you to sing something, you know, with the choir, your voice just sticks out. And so that never happened to me. So.
Wow.
So I love going to church, and I used to sing in the jazz clubs. I love jazz. Because my mother was a singer, and she
really?
Was also a certified public accountant as well. And she used to sing at night and work in the daytime. So, and my mother could play a piano. She can literally make a piano rock.
Whoa.
She is amazing. So, and my grandmother was a soprano. She sung in the choir at church. And my mother used to play for the church. And she also played a lot of jazz. And so there's a lot of music in my house all the time. Anything from Dinah Washington, Sarah Vaughan, Nancy Wilson, all the jazz greats, you know, we never even watched TV that much. The only thing we watched on TV were probably shows that had musical shows like Andy Williams in those days and stuff like that. I started singing actually professionally at 13, believe it or not.
Wow.
Because I started recording with different jazz groups. One was called Contemporary Celebration of Life. And I did an album with him. We traveled all over Lafayette, Indiana, and places like that. And after that, I got with this band, and it was like an R&B band, and the band was called Mood Mixers.
Okay.
And there was two guys in the band. There was one guy in the band. His name was L.J. Johnson. I'm sure you are familiar with him. And L.J. Johnson, and then there was another guy named Pumpkin. I still don't know Pumpkin's name to this day. His name is Pumpkin. That's all I know. So people ask me out there, what's his name? I said, I don't know. His name is Pumpkin. So one of the guys in the band said, look, Evelyn, we're going to go and try out for this recording contract. I said, where? He says, LJ Johnson already has one. I said, what? He didn't tell me anything. So he says, well, I'm going to go try out for it. This is Pumpkin, right?
Yeah.
So Pumpkin says, you're going to go along for the ride? I said, sure. So I went along for the ride. I had on these dirty jeans and dirty gym shoes and a little funky little t-shirt. I mean, I wasn't looking like much of nothing, you know. My hair was pulled back in the ponytail because I'm always wearing a ponytail. And there we were in Danny Leek's house. Danny Leek is the producer of Poison.
Ooh.
And we're sitting in Danny Leek's house. He's one of the biggest producers, engineers, audio engineers you could ever have in those days. And so there sat Ian Levine. So Ian Levine, cigarette in his mouth with a Coca-Cola. Okay, sing. He's telling Pumpkin to sing. So Pumpkin sings, and they went in the back and he started discussing a few things. And then I don't know why he didn't like Pumpkin. He liked his voice, but there was something else that he didn't like, and I don't know what it was. But anyway, he said to me, Pumpkin came to me, he says, you know, you really got to try out for this recording contract. I said, with that guy? He's obnoxious. No, I'm not doing that. He's, you know. he says, no, go ahead and try out for it. Ask him. So I asked him. I got up enough nerve to ask this man to listen to me, okay? Yeah. So I asked him, I said, would you listen to me? And maybe, you know, he says, no. I'm not looking for any female vocalist. I already have a female vocalist, and that was Barbara Pennington.
Yeah.
So he already had somebody. I said, so, well, just listen to me for future references. He says, no. I don't want another singer. He's looking at my dirty jeans and my dirty tennis shoes and my little funky T-shirt I had on. I wasn't looking like you could put me on the stage to do anything with me. Not really, you know. he said, so Danny Leek says, come in. He walked him in the back and took him in a room. When he came out the room, he had a cigarette in his hand, the Coca-Cola in the other hand. He says, okay, you got 2 minutes. Sing. And I'm standing there going, this guy is, oh.
under pressure.
Yeah, I mean, that was a lot of pressure. So I sung this song by Gladys Knight and the Pips, Neither One of Us. And I don't even think I got to the chorus. Ian jumps up off the couch and he goes, oh my God, you're so wonderful. You're such an angelic voice. He said, would you like a recording contract? I said, sure.
Why not?
That's how it started with Ian Levine. And then we did a record called Weak Spot. Honey, baby, which hit number 5 on the charts. It was probably, I gotta say this, the music in the United States was very different from the music in the UK, okay? So if you have never been to the UK, I was like, what, 19, 20 years old? If you've never been to the UK before, you really didn't understand the music in the UK, because I was used to the R&B, the jazz, yeah, that kind of thing. And the music in the UK was more pop.
Yeah.
At the time. And so I did this record called Weak Spot. And it was a very innocent, little cute little record. You know, it's my Achilles heel. It breaks my nervous steel. That's my weak spot. Da-da-da. You know, and I'm like, ugh. Don't know what I do, baby. You know, we did it in London. I got back home and he says, he calls me up on telephone. He says, you got to come to the UK. I said, for what? He says, your song went to number 5 on the charts. I said, what chart? I don't know anything about charts, you know? He said, you got to do a TV show called Top of the Pops. He said, it's the biggest TV show you could ever do in the UK. I said, oh, really? I didn't know anything about Top of the Pops either. I said, well, what song am I going to sing? He said, Weak Spot. I said, that silly thing? I'm supposed to sing that? You know, I was completely oblivious to what was going on. I mean, I didn't know anything. I didn't know my feet from my head, okay?
No.
And so I came over and I went over and I did Top of the Pops. It was probably the biggest thing I'd ever done in my entire life musically, you know. And I actually met the person that I loved the most, which was Andy Williams. Mm. He was actually on the show. It was Andy Williams, Squeezebox, and myself. And they walked me over to introduce me to Andy Williams, and I almost melted, you know. So that was a real highlight. And that's basically how my dance music started, you know, because I had never done dance before. I was always doing jazz. So that's how it started.
But I want to know, you know, you told me about Ian Levine and those things. He's a great producer. Everybody knows Hasseldine too, you know. other pop star from Hi-NRG style music. I want to know about Hi-NRG song, you know. Why the name Hi-NRG? I want to know about the beginning of that smash hit.
Well, I tell you, I can't tell you much about the beginning of it, but I can tell you that Ian called me. I was living in New York then. Yeah. And he called me and says, look, I want you to come to the UK to do this new song that I have just produced. And it's called Hi-NRG.
Okay.
So the song was already written before I ever even got there.
Okay.
I went in, I knew Hi-NRG was different, and I knew there was something very special about it. I knew that when I was recording it. And Hans Zimmer, he was instrumental to making Hi-NRG have the sound that it had. You know, that, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And Hans Zimmer had, he's got that thing, you know, he knows how to do that. And then you had Fearco Trench, who was a great writer. And Ian Levine. So that team together, they had that going on before I ever got there. When I got in there, I basically, you know, when Ian puts me in the studio, he goes, go produce yourself. You know, that's what he tells me. Because he knows if I hear the music, I can hear melody right away.
Yeah.
So I think between the team, between all of us together, that's how Hi-NRG sort of blended, you know. I had like jazz tonations from my voice, and Ian produced the way he produces. Hans Zimmerman had put his touch to it. Fearco Trench, he did his thing, and it just all came together. Mm-hmm. And as I sat back and listened to Hi-NRG when we got finished recording it, I knew. Paul Savory was there too. Nice guy, great guy.
Great.
And I knew something was special about it.
It was only last week that we first met when I was walking down the street.
Then when I went home, I went back to the States. And I think maybe 5 or 6 weeks later, Ian called me to let me know that Hi-NRG had reached the charts. So this time I was kind of, I understood. Okay, I know what Top of the Pops is this time. So I went over. I can't remember exactly how long it was before he called me, but I went over and I did Top of the Pops, and that started a whole new thing.
Wow.
Yeah, but we had records out way before that. We had Have a Little Faith in Me. We had Weak Spot. We had we did quite a bit of recording. So in 1984, that's when Hi-NRG came out.
Mm-hmm. Great that you. You traveled all Europe, Germany, France, and now in these years, you're still doing that. It's incredible, the feeling of that song, you know, in the people, the feeling of that song. It's really Hi-NRG. It's a really Hi-NRG. It's fantastic that.
Yes, it is. Like I was telling you, it was hard to follow up. They tried to follow it up, but everything just went poop. You know, it's not going to happen. Hi-NRG is just one of those songs that, you know, how you can have one of those songs that just, that's just.
Yeah.
Ooh, Hi-NRG, yeah. Your love is lifting me.
I want to know, in your personal opinion, if you could go back in time, will you change something of your professional career?
Would I change some things? I would probably add some things. I would add some things, not particularly changing them. I would like to have gone into some acting,
mm-hmm.
because I love to act and I love writing. I'm writing now. I'm writing a book. I'm writing children's music.
Nice.
I just wrote my own. I produced my own EP just coming out. So I've been doing that a lot. But I would have gone into more television because I like television.
Great. You have new stuff coming. I wanna know about that.
Oh yeah, Work That Thing is that's a heck of a title. It's more, you know, my music is more inspirational, but Hi-NRG was inspirational as well. But the songs that I write, I'm writing now, and I'm also I went to school for audio engineering because I kind of got a little impatient of waiting for people to do things for me. So I said, you know, I think I better learn how to do this for myself, you know. So I went to school for audio engineering, and it was probably the best thing I've done, you know, because it gave me another side of the music industry. Because when you're on one side of it and you're the artist and you're singing, that's just one side of it. But when you get on the other side and understand why are they asking you these questions while they're in the studio, yeah. And say, oh, now I get it, you know, so you put it all together. And so now I'm writing my own music, and my music is very inspirational. I'm very concerned about, you know, because of what we've been going through so much.
Yes.
So many things have been happening, the COVID, the this, the that, the this, the monkeypox, you know, it's all kind of stuff going on. And I want my music to inspire to keep going. So that's what my Work That Thing is all about. So I'm kind of like a binge of helping people get to where they gotta go.
You better get on down for your crown, baby. You better, you better work that thing. You better work that thing.
I don't know if you wanna send any message to all your fans, not only here in South America, you know, all around the world. I think that this is a good opportunity.
Well, number one, I want to thank you for having me on your beautiful cast, and thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I'd like to thank all my fans for their years of support and how they've loved me over the years. And you have no idea what that means to me. I mean, since I was 7 years old, this is something I've always wanted. So you guys make it possible, and I thank you so very much. That's what I would like to say.
Great. I really appreciate it. I know that you had a really hard situations. It was a difficult period to you. I'm very happy, you know, to be here talking to you. I'm a big fan of your music from the 80s. It was such an honor, you know. You can imagine, but it's such an honor for me. Such an honor. Incredible, Dan. I love it.
Well, I'm honored as well. You know, sometimes people say to me, what do you think about your fans coming to see you and want an autograph? I'm more excited to see them than they are to see me. So, you know, that goes both ways for me, you know.
Oh, my God. Thank you very much. I wish you the best, you know, I wish you the best from the bottom of my heart.
Thank you.
And thank you very much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me. No. God bless.